Why does love always seem so very hard? It's such a struggle to win the reward, because I'm playing with the wrong cards, but I think I got the winning hand. There's something different about you, baby, that tells me I can. I say it's easy for the things that you do. Never a question, always a pleasure to love you, love you, love you. Maybe I won't say no. I'm hooked and I can't let go. I'm bound and I can't let go. Oh, this love, it's so natural to give my love. It's so easy like second nature. It's so natural to give my love. It's so easy like second nature. Welcome, welcome, welcome y'all to Cinnamon Says. I am your host, Miss Alicia Cinnamon, aka Toronto's Favorite Spice. And this is a show where we discuss all things and everything. And we're gonna get it popping today with your hot topic, so stay tuned. All right, so let's get right into today's first hot topic, one that I'm sure we're all familiar with and probably a little bit sick and tired of: quarantine. How are y'all coping with COVID-19? Now, I know a lot of people are probably like, they can't wait for outside to open back up, and they're probably losing their mind and stressed out, but I decided to take a different approach. I wanted to use this side to tap into a different side of my creative aspects to really show you guys who Alicia Cinnamon is. Now, most of you guys know me as Toronto's Favorite Spice, singer, songwriter, and all that good stuff. However, I am a person who is really, really keen on researching, and I love knowing what's going on in the world. So I wanted to take this time to come up with something that I've kind of been putting off for a while, which is my talk show, hence Cinnamon Says. So this show, we're going to discuss all different types of things, from music to controversy to what's going on in my life to having special guests, just a little bit of everything, because really and truly, we don't know when outside is going to open back up again, right? So as a creative, we have to maintain creativity. Now, there's some positive parts about COVID that I wanted to discuss alongside the negative parts. So let's go with the positive. The positive for me personally is being able to tap into a different side, taking this time to be still, to be creative, to listen to my inner sense of self, and really, really find out who I am. A lot of people's demons are going to come out, but a lot of people's good sides are going to come out. What do you really want to do with your time? If there's a business that you wanted to start, if you're an artist, low-key, and you wanted to come out, now's your time. Like, there's nothing to hold us back. The playing field is even. Everybody's on the same level, and it's who's going to make most of this factory reset right now. So for my creative people, whether you want to drop an album, whether you want to come up with a talk show, whether you just need to check in with some people, because honestly, the way how life is set up, we're constantly on the go, 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 that we don't really get the time to holler at the people that we should be checking in on. And right now, there's virtually no excuse. I know some people are using it as an opportunity to say, well, you know, I'm going through some stuff right now, so don't take it personally if I don't check in. But hey, if a person has time to update their status on Facebook, if a person has time to share a funny meme, they have time to check in with you. Now, we're not talking about extreme cases where some people might be going through, you know, some really, really hard, detrimental times. They might be suicidal. They might be living in an abusive environment and can't get out of it. That's totally different. And that's where you need to start checking in on your friends, because I'm sure we all know at least one person who's probably not doing okay. And this can be a victim's nightmare. If you are sitting at home with the person who abuses you, whether you're a child who's being physically, mentally, emotionally, or sexually abused, whether you're a man or a woman who's being assaulted, because the domestic violence rates are going out the roof. Suicide is out the roof right now. Imagine being stuck at home with the monster 24/7. A lot of people's escape route was work or school or daycare. So honestly, take this time to be a little less selfish and a little more selfless and check on everybody around you. Because a lot of people will wear a happy face and they'll smile, and then all of a sudden you see them on the 6 o'clock news that they've, you know, passed away, committed suicide, jumped off a balcony or whatever, because it's easy to pretend like everything is okay. We live in a society where social media only wants us to present the best of the best of us. We don't actually get to show who we truly are. So I decided to take this opportunity to show who I truly am, flaws and all. And all of my guests that come through to Cinnamon Says, they're just going to give you raw cinnamon, who they are 100%, obviously within reason, but we're not going to hold back anything on this show, because I know as an artist, sometimes I feel so confined and restricted to who people want me to be, and then there's who I really am. And this just gave me an opportunity just to show people, this is who I am. Hate it or love it, the underdog's on top. So, coping with COVID for me has been great. I've taken this opportunity, you know, to check in with family a little bit more, to cook a lot more, to read a lot more, and most importantly, to write music. I can't wait for you guys to hear the new music that I have coming up for you guys, but I'm taking my time with this because I don't want to rush it. I don't want to pressure myself at all. I want just to interact with my audience, get to know you guys on a different basis, on a different level. And you guys are, feel free to email me at aliciacinnamonbookings@gmail.com with any controversial or non-controversial topics that you guys want me to personally discuss. Because really and truly, this show is not just about me. It's about all of us. So, Cinnamon Says.
Hey, yo, so late. You ever been in a relationship with a man and all he does is lie, lie, lie? Now you see, real ladies, we don't get mad. Oh no. You see, real ladies, you know what we do? We get even. So you met your girlfriend, baby, and I nearly lost my mind. Thinking about you drives me crazy. How is such a waste of time? I never should have met your lady. You just wanna bump in mine. It's time for me to leave you, baby. It's time for me to say I'm mine. I'm not the girl that you wanna be. Creeping on the low, daddy for me. I'm not the girl. Boy, you know I always hate you, 'cause you're with me. La, 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 'cause you. La, 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 like you. Some real peeps. Maybe I should tweak my money and let's hope you'll never handle it. Oh, no. Yeah, 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 yeah. Creeping on me.
Oh, you didn't think I'm gonna say that, Bob? That's what happened when you. Yeah,
begging for the light of color.
All right, so we're gonna get into our second hot topic, which is, of course, relationships and the drama that can or cannot come with it. So you guys just seen me perform my hit song, Liar's Game, and that's honestly one of my favorite songs to perform. So just a little cine fact about that track. That's actually the first song I ever recorded. I wrote it. It was basically, you know, I was just going through a rough relationship. Ironically, as simple as that song sounds, it took me about 3 years, 2 to 3 years to complete that song because I had to finish the relationship before I could finish the track. And pretty much pretty self-explanatory, right? Being in a relationship with somebody who lies. Now, you can be bitter, you can be hurt, you can be angry, or you can realize, ladies and gentlemen, that you are the ish, and you can just keep it moving and find somebody who's going to treat you right. And that goes into my next topic of love and relationships dealing with narcissists. Now, this is a very, very controversial topic because a lot of people are not aware of when they are dealing with narcissistic people, and it can be very, very detrimental. So I just want to give you guys some basic guidelines, right? I'm going to actually read to you guys, first of all, the definition of a narcissist and then how to spot them and how to deal with them. So, narcissistic personality disorder is a personality disorder characterized by a long-term pattern of exaggerating feelings of self-importance, an excessive need for admiration, and a lack of empathy towards other people. So ladies, I'm going to talk to you guys for a second because I'm a woman. Fellas, don't get offended. I'm just speaking from my point of view as a female. Like I said in Liar's Game, you ever been in a relationship with a person and all they do is lie, 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 and you constantly feel like as if nothing that you can do or nothing that you do is good enough for that person. If you feel like your energy is constantly decreasing and you're constantly giving, 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 giving to this person, but it's not being reciprocated, you're probably dealing with either a sociopath, if it's painful, or a narcissist. And during Liar's Game, when I was writing that song, I was going through one of the most narcissistic relationships I could ever possibly encounter. And what it did was it made me a stronger person. Because it made me realize that it's not really about me, it's about them. And it's something that people seriously need to take in. It's not as painful as it can be when you're in those situations. These people can't help themselves. And when you understand why people do what they do, you learn to take it with a different approach. I don't want to say it doesn't hurt as much, but you understand the energy that's coming in with it a little bit better, right? So, the first thing you do when you're in a relationship with a narcissistic person is get out. That's first and foremost. There's nothing you can do to fix it. There's nothing you can do to better it. All you're going to do is lose yourself. Ladies, your body is an internal temple. Every person that you sleep with, lay with, becomes a part of you. And if that person is not in a healthy mindset, narcissistics, they look for people that are happy, that are healthy, and they drag you down to your lowest, 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 lowest point. So if you're feeling like you're with somebody and you're constantly, nothing you do, like I said, is good enough for that person, get out of the relationship. There's nothing that you can ever do that's going to fix that relationship. So I know a lot of people say, oh, you know, Cinnamon seems like she's a man hater and she's this and she's that. It's really not that. I'm just really about women breaking the societal norms that we have to accept the stuff that's being placed upon us, mostly cultural things that you have to accept. If you are going to be with somebody who wants to be in a polygamous relationship, make it be known and do it the right way. Call it a polygamy colony, whatever you want to call it. All women know each other. All parties know each other. They interact. They get along. Everybody's happy-go-lucky. That's how you're going to do it. If you're with somebody who's hiding you, who's sneaking around, who can't post you, but that's supposed to be your man, that is not a relationship. Chances are there's other people involved in that person's life, and that is the game of a liar. So, ladies and gentlemen, pay attention to your inner energy, your inner sense of self, and how it feels when you're around that person. You're valuable, you're beautiful, and every person, no matter where you are, what you've done in your life, what you've done in your past, every person is deserving of love. And the first thing a narcissist will make you feel like is if you're the only person, or they're the only person that is ever going to love you, that nobody else is going to make you feel good about yourself. So you might as well just give up all your goals, dreams, and aspirations and be with that person. If you're ever feeling that way, get out. There's nothing that you can do. Relationships are supposed to be positive. They're supposed to, they're going to have, you know, good and bad moments, but they're supposed to make you feel better. You can do bad by yourself. So if you're with somebody and they're not helping you, whether it's financially, physically, spiritually, mentally, get out of the liar's game and keep it moving. So Cinnamon says,
was just 15, didn't know what his life could be. Now we'll never know, cause his life was cut short. All of this violence followed by silence. Nobody's seen nothing yet, everybody talks of it. When all my people gonna start acting right? Breaks my heart, all we do is fight. In this world of life, I feel I gotta break the rule. I feel I gotta break away. In this world of life, I feel I gotta break the rule. I know I gotta break away. A father's only son, amongst friends he was number one. Jack of all trades, and he did things the right way. Mama, don't cry, he is by God's side. And he don't sleep at night, so you don't know why. We gotta deal with all this pain, all this pain and this suffering. What's it gonna end? Can it all just go away? In this world of hate, I feel like I'm breaking through. I feel like I'm breaking away. In this world of hate, I feel like I'm breaking through. I know I gotta break away. Is this what our ancestors died for? So that we can become the oppressors of ourselves? You see, all this hatred among us has gotta end. Remember, you come from kings and queens. Show your love. Young ladies, respect your bodies as well as your mind. Young men, it's not a weakness to be kind. You only live once, so live it wise. Your time will come when you have to answer to the Most High. In this world of hate, I feel I gotta break through. I feel I gotta break away. I can't breathe. In this world of hate, I feel I gotta break through. I know I gotta break away. I can't breathe. In this world of hate, I feel I gotta break through. I know I gotta break away.
Right there was written for a young man named Tyson Bailey who was gunned down in Regent Park in 2013. And that song is really near and dear to me because I was originally asked to sing at Tyson Bailey's funeral. And when I got there, that was the first funeral I ever attended first dead body I've ever seen in my entire life outside of a movie. So it was really surreal for me. And it was the first time that I realized how much one person's death can impact so many people. There was at least maybe about 400 or 500, maybe more people there. School was shut down. CBC News was there. Everybody was there. And Tyson pretty much was a really good kid who was in the wrong place at the wrong time with the wrong people. And when I wrote that song, I sang at the funeral a few songs that the family had picked, because they're a musical family, but wasn't in the mindset to perform, so they hired me. And after I left, I realized he had like a young girlfriend there, and you know, the sister was trying to jump in the grave, and it was just really, really real for me. And I went directly from the funeral. I remember this day as clear as day. I left the funeral in the middle of a snowstorm. I went to the studio and I told my producer that I wanted to write something to preserve Tyson's memory in a positive light, because I seen the anger and the frustration that was coming from the youths, and I knew that retaliation was about to happen. Now, just to give you guys an idea of the ambience, so to speak, the environment at the time, during that time there was about 2 or 3 young men who had been killed prior to that, and the pastor that was at Tyson's funeral was the pastor at those 2 funerals, and those funerals got shot up at the funeral. So a lot of people were on edge because we were hoping that, you know, the gunmen wouldn't come through and shoot up the funeral, because it was just the year of the bullets. Things were just going crazy. And I knew that retaliation was about to come. So I went and I wrote I Can't Breathe, I would say, in maybe about 20 minutes. And it originally started off on Etta James' I'd Rather Go Blind instrumental. And I performed it I sent it to the family first, because I didn't want to capitalize off of Tyson's death. I sent it to the family and I said, do you mind, you know, if I just do something just to, so you guys can have for yourself to preserve him in a positive light? The family was very grateful, and then I started tweeting it to some of the friends, anybody that I went, looked in the hashtags and seen anybody that hashtagged Tyson Bailey, and I sent it to them. A few of his friends reshared it, and before I knew it, CBC News covered the song, did an interview on me as one of 6 Black Canadians making a difference in their community. And it was at that moment that I realized that, okay, I was just doing weddings, birthdays, funerals, wasn't really trying to be in the music industry. And it was at that moment that I realized that my platform can be utilized for something bigger than just singing songs or, you know, being a cute face on TV. Like, I could actually be an activist. So I like to use a very a term of endearment for myself, a unique term that a few of us go by. We're called artivists, where it's an artist and an activist combined in one. If you guys go back to my earlier years in the Toronto music industry, every Black Lives Matter rally, anything that you could possibly think of, I was there, I was a part of it, and I'm still going to be a part of it. You know, I've done, you know, campaigning with DeWitt Lee for Trayvon Martin, a lot of different things that were happening at the time, and I felt like, as an artist, how can I do more? I feel it's very selfish just to put out music if it's not reflecting the times. So when I wrote that song, I didn't know where it was gonna go. I didn't really want to put it out or on the radio or anything, because I really didn't want to capitalize off his life. But then a year later, Eric Garner was killed by police officers, and his last words were, I can't breathe. And I thought it was really interesting that a year before I wrote a song called I Can't Breathe, and now that's the slogan for a lot of young Black, or and older Black men as well too. So I realized it was a time to put that song out. I redid it on an original beat, kind of, you know, lighten up the tempo a little bit more to give it that reggae vibe, so that it didn't depress people after they heard it, because that song has a very strong message where it can change your vibe. So I try to lighten it up a little bit more and just inspire people that better days are to come. Unfortunately, flash forward, we're like, you know, almost 7 years later, and things really haven't changed. The only difference between Tyson's story and some of the stories that are happening now is that Tyson was unfortunately gunned down by probably somebody who was either a friend or an associate. You know, it's Black on Black, as silly as that term is, but that's what it was. Whereas flash forward now, the police brutality is at an all-time high. One thing that I'm really grateful with social media is that let me retract that statement. Police brutality has always been like this, but now we're finally able to capture it and see it for ourselves. Black, white, Chinese, old, young, you cannot hide it. just like, you know, with the pedophile rings with Pizzagate and everything that's going on right now can't be hidden. So we're in a moment, in a time where everything is being, all the demons are being exposed for who and what they really truly are. And I wanted to talk about a topic that resonated really near and dear to me. It happened in Georgia, and for those of you guys who are not familiar with me, Atlanta, particularly in Georgia, has a very strong presence in who Alicia Cinnamon is. That's where I dropped my first album. That's where, you know, I did soap opera, so to speak. I've done a lot of performances, a lot of festivals out there. So Atlanta's like my second home. But what a lot of people don't realize with Atlanta is that Atlanta, and like, it's kind of like Toronto. It's like Atlanta and maybe the GTA is for black people and predominantly black people. But once you get on those outskirts of Atlanta, it's basically like stepping into the 1950s. I've had friends that moved to Canada because they've had crosses burned on their lawns. And this is like in the 2000s. This is like maybe 4 or 5 years ago. So it hasn't really changed as much as we think it has. But I'm really just grateful that Atlanta, the core Atlanta, is thriving. But there's still a lot of police brutality and a lot of very southern mentality in terms of, you know, slavery. So there's a story that I wanted to discuss with you guys. And and the man's name is Ahmed Arbery, right? The parents of a black man slain in a pursuit by two white men armed with guns called for immediate arrest Wednesday as they faced the prospect of waiting a month or longer before a Georgia grand jury could consider bringing charges. A swelling outcry over the February 23rd shooting of Ahmed Arbery intensified after a cell phone video that purports to showing the killing surfaced on Tuesday. Following the video's release, a large crowd of demonstrators marched in the neighborhood where Arbery was killed, and the state opened its own investigations, which the governor and the attorney general pledged to support. The men who pursued Arbery told the police they suspected he had committed a recent burglary. Arbery's mother, Wanda Cooper Jones, told reporters Wednesday she believes her 25-year-old son was just out for his daily jog in a neighborhood outside the port city of Brunswick. She hasn't watched the video. "I saw my son come into the world," Jones said, "and seeing him leave the world is not something that I ever want to see." That's deep. Benjamin Crump, an attorney for Marcus Arbery, Ahmed's father, said the video is very clear. They were on the trucks with guns hunting him down. "I don't know what more you need to make an arrest." A Georgia prosecutor said Tuesday he wants a grand jury to decide if criminal charges are warranted in the death of Arbery, 25 years old. Attorneys for Arbery's family said the father and son who grabbed guns and pursued Arbery in a truck after seeing him running in their neighborhood should be arrested now before a grand jury decides whether to indict them, as often happens in criminal cases. "These men were vigilants. They were a posse and they formed a modern lynching in the middle of the day," said Lee Merritt, an attorney for Arbery's mother. Merritt also said the U.S. Justice Department should investigate Arbery's death as a hate crime. Tom Durden, an outside prosecutor assigned to examine the case, said he plans to have a grand jury hear the evidence. That won't happen for more than a month, as Georgia courts remain partially closed because of coronavirus until at least June 13. I am of the opinion that this case should be presented to the grand jury of Glynn County for consideration of criminal charges against those involved in the death of Mr. Arbery," Durden said in a statement on Tuesday. "Struggled followed by gunshots. Reached by the phone," Durden said, no arrests have been made in connection with the shooting. He declined to say what charges he would have the grand jury consider. The cell phone video initially posted by a Brunswick radio station shows a black man running at a jogging pace on the left side of a two-lane road. A truck is parked in the road ahead of him, one man in the pickup bed and another standing beside the open driver's door. The runner crosses the road to pass the pickup on the passenger side, then crosses back in front of the truck. A gunshot sounds, and the video shows the runner grappling with a man in the streets over what appears to be a shotgun or a rifle. A second shot can be heard, and the runner can be seen punching the man. A third shot is fired at point-blank range. The runner staggers a few feet and falls face down. What more do we need for justice and for vindication? And you see, this is where we as a people, we need to come together, because when they see us treating each other like animals, they think it's okay for them to treat us like animals, because they think that we really don't matter. The fact that people always like to challenge the Black Lives Matters hashtag with All Lives Matters is a clear reason or a clear understanding of the fact that people really just don't get it. It's not that Black Lives Matter more than white lives or blue lives or yellow lives or any other lives. It's that our lives don't even seem to matter at all, period. How on earth are we living in 2020 where a Black man can be jogging down the street and get gunned down in his own area? Before that, Trayvon Martin. It's something that's been happening from the dawn of time, or at least until from the dawn of, blacks in North America following slavery. When is it gonna end? But right now, people, we need to start doing better for ourselves. We honestly need to start sticking together. We need to start rallying and protesting at the top of our lungs. We can't just keep resharing memes and flyers and stuff like that. We gotta go down to these courthouses. We gotta be in these people's faces. We gotta talk about this stuff at the top of our lungs. We have to govern what's going on in our own community. We gotta govern our own. Like, we really and truly need to start taking care of ourselves. We need to start addressing the demons that are in our community. We need to start holding meetings, town meetings, community meetings, on finding out what is it that we want. We can't ask, we can't make demands if we don't even know what the demands are that we need to be met yet. We just know that there's a problem and we're angry and we're frustrated, and I get it. But, we need to start raising our youths to maybe incorporate a few more of them on the police field so that we have some brothers on our side and sisters. Maybe we need to start back up the Black police force task, especially in the U.S. We need to show people that our lives matter to ourselves first, so that society can realize that our lives matter as well too. Things like what's going on in China with the Africans. I'm so happy to see Africa go into China and take back their people and say, look, enough is enough. For 400-500 years, you guys have just been taking advantage of our people throughout the world. Black people have been taken advantage of, and it's time that we start tapping into our greater sense of self. It's time that we start showing society that we are valuable to society. We are assets. We are not liabilities. Our lives should matter just as much as everybody else. Black men should not have to be prepped before walking out their house on where to go, how to walk, how to dress, how to talk. Black females should not have to be prepped on what to wear, how to look, how to control our aggressiveness, how to speak at a tone that doesn't come across as angry or miserable or bitter. We need to teach our children that it's okay to aspire for greatness. It's okay to want more out of life. That doesn't make you whitewashed. It doesn't make you a gold digger if you're a female that wants to marry up. It doesn't make you anything. We need to teach our Black men, if you want to date outside your race, there's nothing wrong with that, but you don't gotta diss your Black queens in the process. Love who you want to love, but if you don't love yourself, people are going to see that. You cannot fool the world. And right now the world is realizing that God's gems, God's children, don't seem to understand who they truly are. And they don't seem to value themselves. And so until the world knows who we are, and until we tap into that for ourselves, we're always going to struggle. So I'm really hoping from this time, and this isn't to say that we're better or worse than anybody else, but right now, Black people, we need to come together. The world is showing us how they feel about us. What are we going to do about it? How are we going to show the world that we are valuable? And not even the world, show each other. Show each other. Coming out of this, we need to start supporting more Black-owned businesses. And that doesn't just mean Black people go to Black businesses. It means that you start networking with white people and Chinese people and Indian people, because their dollars matter just as much as ours do too. It's just like how we spend money in their stores. There's nothing wrong with them spending money in our stores or on our products, etc. We need to start thinking the way that the rest of the world thinks. And we need to start having survivor mentalities and not victim mentalities. Because we are an amazing set of people. And I think the world knows that. But they just don't want us to know that yet. Cinnamon says. Alright, so we've been hearing about this new world order, right? And I'm a big what you call conspiracy theorist. I like thinking outside the box and realizing that, of course, they're never going to give us 100% of all the information that they have. We got to do some homework and some research for ourselves, right? So what to expect going forward? I know a lot of people are waiting for outside to open back up so they can just go back to the movie theaters and the venues and the parks and all that stuff. But do you guys really think things are going to go back exactly the way that they were? Like, think about it. 5G has been introduced. You got chipping parties that are happening. Literally, you're going to be able to order an Uber and just say, Uber, come here. And all of a sudden, the Uber's just going to pop up at your doorstep. You're going to be able to buy your groceries with just swiping your wrist. We're going into a whole new world order, guys. And if you're stuck in the old world, you're going to get left behind. So I got some tips for my artist friends. First of all, make sure you are active on social media. Get Twitch, get Facebook, get Instagram, Snapchat, TikTok, Zoom, anything right now. According to Facebook, they're going to be allowing us to perform and get paid for our live streamings. And Facebook's also going to be allowing us to split screen, like how Instagram, you can do two people. So that's awesome. For my Facebook followers, I can't wait for you guys to join me live and direct on Facebook, because it's so crazy to try to merge the two platforms. I'm really glad that Facebook has introduced that new avenue. For DJs, make sure you get on Twitch. Twitch is a great platform for DJs because it doesn't cut the content of your music. You know, when you're on Facebook or Instagram, you get the copyright infringements if you play the songs, I believe it's longer than 45 seconds. So pay attention to that. And more importantly, pay attention to your fan base. Right now is the perfect opportunity. Start up challenges. Talk to your fans. Tory Lanez is a huge inspiration, and I'm bigging him up in the city of Toronto, the GTA, Brampton, whatever you want to call it. He's doing major things right now. His quarantine radio just got picked up, I believe, by MTV, and he's the first person to do a YouTube live streaming concert. I'm going to give Teddy Riley a stripe on that, because Teddy Riley tried to do it. He just wasn't familiar with how to make the equipment work. Tory Lanez just beat him to the punch and got it put together. So artists, we are going to be able to go into the YouTube studios and do our own social distancing tour and go live and direct with our fans across the world. Now, I know a lot of people are like, oh my God, I prefer to perform in front of, you know, the audience because I can get the energy and the reaction. And trust me, I get it. I love feeding off of the energy of the audience. However, think of the bonuses. Babyface and Teddy Riley broke the internet by having over 500,000 people tuned in at once to Instagram just to watch them battle. When are we as artists ever really going to get an opportunity to perform in front of 500,000 people? I don't even think Babyface or Teddy Riley has ever been able to perform in front of 500,000 people all at once. So think about it. People who are in China and Japan and India and Africa and all these other places that won't get to see you if you're a Canadian artist and you aren't able to travel to all those different places, especially right now, they can just sit in the comfort of their own home and watch you and tune in. So artists, pay attention and tap into that. DJs, pay attention and tap into your resources. I cannot stress that enough. We're going into a whole new world order. It's not going to go back to the way that it was. And with that new world order, I just want to encourage people to find peace. Whatever old drama you had, leave it behind in the past. Whatever issues you had, whatever reservations you had about, any self-doubt, leave all of that in the past. Consider this your once-in-a-lifetime factory reset. We don't get to do this, and we probably will never get to do this in our lifetime. I believe the last time the world factory reset was 1918 with the Spanish flu. We're all sitting inside our house. We're all stuck inside of our house unless you're an essential worker. And don't get it twisted. We're all essential. So just keep that in mind. Even if they tell you you're not essential, you are essential. Do not let that get you down. But right now, what we should be focusing on is making sure that we are always essential. Find a way to make yourself essential. Don't worry about what everybody else has to say. There's no rush. There's nothing to panic about. Find another way to be resourceful. Find another means to your income, whatever it is. There's a lot of resources out there, people that are willing to help. Now's the time to be humble. Now's the time to just get rid of ego. And there's nothing wrong with asking for help. Reach out. You'd be surprised how many organizations are out there and how many people individually are just doing things to make a difference in their community. And I love that. I'm one of the people you could reach out to. Hey, if you just need somebody to talk to and shoot the breeze, hit me up in my DMs, and if I'm available, I'll always reply, because there's nothing better in the world than humanity. No matter how much money you have, no matter how much materialistic things you have, just being a humble human being is the best thing you can possibly provide another human being on this face of the planet, in my personal opinion. So, Toronto artists, right now, I encourage you guys to get crack-a-lacking, because with Tory Lanez killing the game right now, you guys would be surprised on how many people are paying attention to us, and they're just coming in and reaching and grabbing, and they're going to take the best of the best. And I know myself, when the borders open back up, I'm out of here. So Toronto, find a way to keep your artists here. Homegrown talent. We got to start supporting our own homegrown talent, playing our music on the radios, booking us for shows, paying us for our shows, and really appreciating our worth. Shout out to all the DJs, all the artists that are going live right now and providing free entertainment. That's huge. Free entertainment in a time where income matters. You know, a lot of people are providing entertainment and they don't even know where their next dollar is going to come from, but they're doing it for the love of music. So show your Toronto artists, your GTA artists, a little bit more of appreciation going forward after this, and really, really just take in what we do is work. It's not just for fun, as easy as we make it look. It is definitely work. So I just want to shout out all my artists in the six in the GTA, all my DJs, all my creatives, all my photographers, all my videographers, all my MCs, whoever you are and you're staying creative right now, salute to you. And trust me, better days are going to come, but pay attention to what's going on, because this is our time to shine. Cinnamon says.
So I'm going to switch it up on y'all, all right? Listen carefully.
Keep music.
Have your own taste sorted. Hear the music on the radio open. Have a life sweet like joking. So I'm your bad man singing and jumping. Have your own taste sorted. Hear the music on the radio open. Have a life sweet like joking. So I'm your bad man. Move over Drake, cause I'm coming for your spot. Forget about the six and the queen of teeth that. I'm an old school chick with an old school vibe. Good news is coming back, cause I'm keeping it alive. I don't care about the money, I just wanna make a song. Think about it over, I can make it sing along. R&B, demon with the spirit of a rapper. Tina taking over, time to change new chapter. What you know about a girl like this? You don't know what's wrong, but you heard about the six. Amy, baby, I'm a 90s girl. Canadian queen, I'm about to take over the world. Toronto, Favorite Spice, I'm Alicia Cinnamon. We can roll with Queenie, guaranteed to take a win. All eyes on my city, it's all the time to shine. I wake up every morning to rise and grind. Come on. Hot yeah, all tears floating. Human is up on the radio open. And my life's sweet, like joking. So if you're bad, my city ain't jumping. Hot yeah, all tears floating. Human is up on the radio open. And my life's sweet, like joking. So if you're bad, man. Baby, get your man, so they talking all that bullshit. Calling up my name every day of the week. Swimming through the brain, cause I hustle while they sleep. And they tryna find out who I was with on the weekend. Yo, what's up, hoe and so-and-so? Man, that girl, she a real hoe. Truth is, I wanna be just like her. Have these dudes online tryna wipe her. So jealous of me, they slip a pill in your drink. So they can make people think that you took a big thing. Running in a beer, like as if you wanna lose. So they can get the main head, cause they can do what it is you do. I keep coming here and watch the company you keep. I never thought this shit would happen to me. But now my life is like a living movie. I'm seeing people's true colors and most of them agree. He don't talk about me and they hating on my name. That's cause I came out of nowhere and I took over the game. The devil couldn't stop me, so he sent me hilarious. But I kicked him out the way and I gotta keep my lady singing. So much about me, so they la-la-la-la-la, they wanna be just like me, so they try to steal my unique style. Mad when I'm laughing like, I feel all tears floating. Hear the music on the radio bumping. And I like sweet, but I don't care. So if you're bad, my city ain't jumping. I feel all tears floating. Hear the music on the radio bumping. And I like sweet, but I don't care. So if you're bad, my city ain't jumping. I feel all tears floating. Hear the music on the radio bumping. And I like sweet, but I don't care. So if you're bad, my city ain't jumping. Bye.
All right, and so for my final topic, you guys, you'll see me have a little bit of fun with that dumpling remix. And I wrote that song to address a couple of issues that were going on in my life, where I realized that a lot of the people that are around me were only around me as opportunists. You know, they would, hey, Cinnamon, we're friends. And yeah, I know Alicia Cinnamon. And yeah, that's my homegirl. But then all these rumors and lies and gossip and slander started coming out. And, you know, as an artist, they tell you, ignore it. Don't pay it any mind. People are just haters. That's what they do. But we're people. And if you really understand the concept of an artist, most of us are emotional, which is why we are artists and write our music, right? So some things are really hard to ignore, especially when they're not true, or especially when you see that they're affecting relationships, friendships, or business around you. So I wrote that song, especially the second verse, just to kind of address, you know, the haters, because we all have them. We all got them. And something that I had to constantly remind myself is nobody's ever tried to rob an empty van. If people are coming for you, it's because you have something incredible to offer. Nobody's going to waste their time on somebody who's invaluable, who is irrelevant, and who they don't think has potential to get to the next level. Now, as they say, familiarity breeds contempt, right? And we live in the screw-face capital of wonderful Toronto. And unfortunately, we haven't figured out just yet how to shed that negative stereotype. I always find it really funny when they say that Canadians are so happy. I don't think people have really met. Maybe they're talking about people from Newfoundland. I don't know. But the average Torontonian is highly miserable. And with that miserableness, you're going to get some haters. Because the reality is, how can people be happy for you if they're not happy for themselves? So my biggest advice for people going forward is embrace your haters. You know why? Because your haters are your number one fans. Your haters keep up with every single thing it is that you do. They know every move you make. They know when you're going to make it, how you're going to do it, and who you're going to do it with. And you, the reason why I say they're your number one fan is because the reason why your haters are able to point out your flaws is because they have higher expectations of you. Think about it. If you're doing some shit, they're like, I would have done it like this. I would have done it like that. It's because they see the potential that you have to do even better. And I know that sounds really crazy, but think about it. Nobody, at least not for me, I don't give criticism or feedback unless I think that person has potential to tap into it and to do better. If I think this is all you can do and this is the best that you're going to do, I'm not going to say nothing to you. I'm just going to let you do you. So something that I've learned to do throughout the duration of my career, because again, those who've been following my career has been filled with controversy, because I'm very transparent with you guys. And my experience isn't unique just to Alicia Cinnamon. This happens to a lot of females and men in the industry, period. I just chose to document my story with you guys along my journey so that when the time comes and my lifetime biopic comes out, you guys get the 100% Alicia Cinnamon truth and not somebody else's version of Alicia Cinnamon. You feel me? So, going back to your haters, something that I really had to condition myself and realize, and there are days, of course, when you cry and you're sad and whatever, but I've learned how to turn negative situations into something positive. The more people talk about me, is the harder I'm going to go. You know why? Because if they're talking about me and I'm talking about me, guess who everybody's talking about? Mwah. And it's beneficial. Because some people are going to come to your page or find, you know, try to reach out to who you are, to find out who you are, just to be nosy. But if you're lit and you're ton up, a lot of those people are going to end up realizing, hey, I kind of like this person. I can kind of see why this person's hating, because this person ain't got nothing going on for them. And here's this person, every day they're working on something special and new and exciting and fun. So when I write my music, you know, I don't always get to, like I said, address every single issue. I wish I could. So I put it in a song. And that's where the Hot Gal remix came from. And it's just dedicated to all my haters. It is not a diss track to Drake, because it starts off with Move Over Drake, I'm coming to your spot. So I remember somebody asked me, oh, you got a diss track to Drake? No, it's basically letting Drake know it's a woman that's running, you know, coming toe to toe. I'm right there, I'm gonna come up for you. And I, you know, we need some females making a name for themselves in the city. Big up Drake, big up Tory Lanez, but we need some women up in the city that can carry as much weight. And every time I go to do an interview in Atlanta, people always ask me, anywhere I go outside of Toronto, do you know Drake? Do you know Drake? Do you know Drake? So I'm like, okay, Drake, I'm coming for your spot. You know, in a friendly way. Big up all the artists in Toronto that are doing their thing. Once again, your girl Cinnamon says 2,000% that you guys need to keep pushing, keep striving, be the best that you can be, and be original. There's already a Drake, There's already a Weeknd. There's already a Tory Lanez. There's already a Jay-Z and everybody else. Find your own sound. Define yourself. Be creative. Toronto has hip-hop, reggae, soca, R&B, rock, everything on the face of the planet. You do not have to box yourself in. Tap into whatever you want. Fuse your music. But just be great. Just be great. And the last thing I'm going to say to you guys is pay respect to those who came before you. Most Toronto artists have no idea what the music industry in Toronto was like 15 or 20 years ago. Do your homework, do your research, find out who came before you, and always, always, always give credit, because none of us could do this by ourselves. As much as I say I'm an independent artist, and I am independent and I do a lot of things alone, I always have people that are able to assist me and help me out. So there's independent, yes, but of course, we can, you know, no man, no woman is an island. So give credit where it's due. If there's one message that I can get out to the world right now while I wrap this segment up, our first ever episode of Cinnamon Says, is honestly use this time to be who you really and truly are. Get rid of the old exterior. Get rid of all the old pressure that people applied on you. All the stuff that people told you from a child to an adulthood. That to everybody who told you who you were, now is the time for you to tell the world who you are. Tap into your greatness and do not waste this opportunity. If you come out the same person that you went in quarantine as, you've wasted a lot of valuable time. Cinnamon Says.